What's up? Welcome to this week's 4th and 1. I'm here with my co-host Elvis or Ellie. What do you want? What do you want to call?
Either way.
Okay, we'll go with Ellie. I think I've always
called it. It's going to be the highest rated show that you've had thus far. Let's just.
I think so.
Believe me.
Believe me. All right, and today with 4th and 1, we're doing something a little different. Today we're talking about basketball. We're not really a basketball podcast, but today we're taking on the NBA All-Star Weekend. Russell Westbrook and the Cleveland Cavaliers. So I've got Ellie here because he's my basketball friend. I guess of all my friends, you're kind of like the one friend who knows basketball most. So let's start off with, I guess first topic, Russell Westbrook not being named an All-Star. I think that's like the biggest snub in the world. I mean, he's averaging a triple-double, and that hasn't been done since 1970 with Oscar Robinson.
Sure.
Only one guy's ever done it before.
I think, like, you gotta really put everything into perspective.
Okay.
I think whenever some kind of news like this comes out, you gotta, okay, it's unbelievable, but just take a step back, and after a couple of weeks, you gotta consider, who are you leaving off? Right? Like, okay, so we got between Westbrook, Harden, and Curry. So the number one, obviously, I think Harden's there. Harden is going to be on the team because he should win MVP this year.
He should.
I called that one at the beginning of the year,
James
by the way.
James Harden, oh my God. Okay, unreal.
Harden, hang on.
An assist machine this year.
Crazy. Yeah. What is he? Do you know what he's averaging?
I don't have it here. I don't have his average here, but I'll pull it up.
I think it's like 11 or something. I don't know, but you should.
Yeah, so it's a ridiculous stat.
But okay, so it's such a weird thing in the NBA. Look at last year. Do you know who was on the starting lineup in the Western Conference? Kobe.
See, no.
Kobe Bryant.
But that that's part of the farewell tour.
Sure. But okay, so let me finish my point. So Kobe was a starter last year.
Right.
Kobe was a starter the year before. Both years he had
didn't deserve to be there.
A career low shooting percentage. Last year he averaged 17.6 points.
Yeah.
Less than 3 rebounds, less about 3.7 assists, or I might be getting those two in reverse.
Right.
But they did it to show, okay, it's Kobe, right?
Right.
With Steph Curry, you got a guy who's won the last two MVPs.
And the first person to ever be a unanimous MVP.
Unanimous MVP. First time even ahead of Michael Jordan didn't even do that.
Right.
So when you're picking guys, you're like, okay, Harden, straight away, I think he should get in. Then you look at a guy like Steph Curry who just won two MVPs in a row. When you look at the grand scheme of things, yeah, it's crazy. Westbrook had averaging a triple-double. It's insane. But you have to factor in, first of all, the Curry thing. If it was up to me, I heard someone was saying, but you have to, like, the way they set it up, you got to take 2 backcourt and then 3 front court.
Right.
If it was me, I would have taken out Kawhi Leonard. And that's not to say, hang on. That's not to say Kawhi Leonard. I think Kawhi Leonard is the second best basketball player in the league.
Maybe third.
Like,
so
in
you
overall.
Go, so you go,
in
like,
overall.
So you go LeBron, Kawhi Leonard?
LeBron, and then like 2A, 2B is Durant and Kawhi. Like, dude, if you take into consideration the defense is so important to me. Like,
yeah.
as watching basketball, and you're like, man, what guy do I want on my team? Like, LeBron, yeah.
Can guard anyone. Kawhi Leonard. Yeah.
But this is an All-Star game. So another thing you have to look at is entertainment value.
Yeah.
Like, Kawhi Leonard is not an entertainment value guy. Westbrook 100% is. So if you're going to be starting to, if it was a perfect world,
yeah,
I would have Curry, I would have obviously KD, I would have Harden, and I would have Westbrook there.
So
because at this point, like, they cut out centers completely. Like,
they got Anthony Davis. That's like
who's a forward, but
he's
actually
the starting
five
center.
The Western Conference actually has more centers on it now than we've seen in the last few years.
Well, yeah, because they got like
DeMarcus Cousins is on there,
Marcus Gasol,
DeAndre, right?
Yeah,
DeAndre Jordan,
Marcus Gasol.
So you got three. You got 3 actual centers, but the All-Star game has went so far away from the centers that why not just, you can stack up your front line with 5 guards. Like, you want entertainment
value
for the fans.
Of those 3 centers, which is the only center that actually matters in the league today? Boogie Cousins is the only.
That's not fair. I wouldn't say DeAndre doesn't matter.
But you're not gonna take DeAndre Jordan and build a team around him, right?
No.
You're gonna take Boogie Cousins and build a team around him, right?
Which they've tried to do and not done well.
Because Boogie Cousins is uncoachable. And I mean, like, it's not like he's been completely slighted. I mean, he's a reserve player on the West All Stars.
Westbrook?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Side note there, James Harden's averaging 11.3
that's
assists.
That's crazy. 11.3 assists. James Harden.
For a guy who's never been an assist guy and who's always been like a ball stopping shooter.
Yeah.
I mean, it's unreal what is it Mike D'Antoni there or
yeah, Mike D'Antoni, yeah.
Mike D'Antoni, yeah.
And that's like his fourth, maybe third stint in
yeah.
as many like he was on what, the Knicks?
Yeah.
And then
the Lakers for a bit.
Yeah, and that didn't work.
And then the Suns for a bit.
But for like if you're Westbrook, man, this is like a popularity I still think he's popular. I still think he's insane, but at the end of the day, it's just a popularity contest, and if you don't get in, like a big part of the All-Star game for the players is the recognition because it contributes to their salary.
It validates.
It actually does contribute cuz yeah. they can go to their GM and say, "Look, Westbrook doesn't need the All-Star game. He's a max player already. Does it like
right? But with the salary, with the salary cap ballooning in a year or two,
he's gonna get max. What he could have been left off the starting lineup, he would have got the same salary. But there's other players like Jimmy Butler, who's kind of on that edge, right? Like everyone's calling him an All-Star this year, but the fact that he's on the starting five,
yep.
that validates him as an All-Star, and he could potentially get max money.
Yeah, but
in his next contract negotiation.
You know what I really hate about the NBA All-Star system is that they still have fan voting, right?
What do you? How is this?
Giannis Antetokounmpo.
That guy is amazing. That guy is amazing. I'm sorry.
He's good, but let me teach
you basketball, man. That guy is going to be so good. He already this year is starting to pick up and become an All-Star.
Paul George is behind him.
Paul George didn't play.
He's a reserve.
Like almost the whole season. But there's a reason. If he played the whole, I think Paul George is
insane. Isaiah Thomas is a reserve.
But he's okay,
get rid of the Greek guy and put in like.
But who do you no? But, okay.
Kimball, give me Kimball Walker.
Over Isaiah?
No, over the Greek.
Yeah, but okay. Who are you? Who's there? Like you got to replace. If you're gonna put Isaiah Thomas in, you're either taking who? Kyrie or who else is there? DeRozan?
No. Kyrie's in the starting five, and DeRozan's starting five.
So you're not taking either of those two guys off.
You can't
take Antetokounmpo out because he's a front court player again. So we're going back to my perfect world.
Okay.
Analysis of
okay.
if we how's, can do that. Okay, we can take Kawhi Leonard out, put Westbrook in, and I would agree with.
How's this?
I would agree
with how's that. This? Take Antetokounmpo out and put in Kevin Love. I know that now he's.
I don't think Kevin Love should be.
I know that Kevin Love is hurt now, and so he's not going to be in it. But like just for the sake of ordering it,
so you replaced them.
Who replaced them?
Carmelo.
Carmelo's also there too on the reserve list.
Yeah, because he was he on the All-Star team? I thought I saw something that he's replacing Kevin Love.
Okay, so now if we didn't have to go two backcourt and three frontcourt, right?
Yeah.
And we could just take the five best players or the five most exciting players, whoever you wanted to do that in order, right? Okay, I would agree. Kevin Durant, Steph Curry, James Harden, right?
Yep.
I'd take Kawhi Leonard because I want to see some wicked blocks. I don't want to see some like sick defense, right?
So then you take Anthony Davis out.
Yes, I'm taking Anthony Davis off. And I'm putting in Russell Westbrook because no one plays more explosively and more excitingly in the NBA than Russell Westbrook. He is fueled by anger the same way Tom Brady is fueled by anger.
But he comes up soft again. Like, I mean, actually, he did have a good game against OKC.
But I just like
weeks ago, but.
The way he is so vengeful and how he plays. Like if you told him before the game, you know, I don't like the way your shoes are tied, he'd dunk right on you and just completely posterize you.
Does he talk to Kevin Durant? Does he shake his hand?
Are they friends? Is that what you're asking me?
No, I'm saying, does he talk to him at the All-Star game because of all the?
No.
Have you not followed all the?
No, he is not going to talk to him.
You don't think so? I hope he does. I hope he doesn't.
Kevin Durant got that pass for I think it was like the week one of. Week one of the NFL where Kevin Durant became like a sideline photojournalist for the NFL for like week one.
Yeah, yeah.
And then Westbrook trolled him wearing the pink or the bright green poncho thing, right?
Yeah, I don't know.
They are not going to talk. There is so much bad blood.
It seems Kevin
Durant has said all the wrong things since leaving.
In the last game, like leading up to that game,
yeah.
I think it was a week ago, Kevin Durant has been slowly putting in the message that he wants to talk to Russell Westbrook. Like he's just telling the media basically to leave us alone. We're gonna hash it out how we're gonna hash it out.
That's fine,
but Westbrook's not gonna have any of it. Westbrook is like, he's on his team, I'm on my team, just leave it at that. like, I think Kevin Durant might make an attempt to do something, but I don't think Russell should, just to keep the intensity going.
Durant can try all he want, but Westbrook's not going to have any of it. Westbrook is going to, like, Durant's going to go try and shake his hand, and Westbrook is just going to slap him in the face.
Yeah, I don't know. I don't think he should do it, but.
Since Durant left, right, all he said is, you know, like, I want to play in a place where I'm, you know, a top player, and he's basically said everything negative. Without actually saying, I hate Russell Westbrook, everything he has said has implied that he just thought Russell Westbrook was a ball hog couldn't play with him.
I think the point there is that he kept Westbrook in the dark. Like, Westbrook had to find out from the media.
Unfair.
I think if KD came up to him, I mean, it's history, right? But I think if KD came up to
Similar to when LeBron had the show for going to Miami, the big reveal, right? No one
You're talking about LeBron?
Yeah. No one faults LeBron for going to Miami for a few years.
The way he did it.
He did it, right? Yeah. And this is the same problem that Westbrook has with Kevin Durant. It's not that Kevin Durant left Westbrook. It's the way he left it's the way Durant left Westbrook. Westbrook feels slighted. And of all the teams you would go to as Durant,
you go to the team that doesn't need you.
How could you go to the only team in the league that doesn't need you?
Yeah.
And you almost just beat
3-1. And you should have closed it out. But that's a different story.
You know, speaking of 3-1, I mean, the Warriors also blew a 3-1 lead, so.
That's true.
Who's to say what would have happened?
I don't know, but I think he should have stuck it out.
All right. I guess that's good for now. I mean, that's like 10 minutes. I feel like we've covered that pretty comprehensively. Unless you got more thoughts on the All-Star game.
That was 11 minutes.
Yeah. I mean, I kind of want to talk about Boogie Cousins. I mean,
on the starting line, what is there to say about him?
I think he needs to be traded so badly. Send him to the Knicks.
They were talking about the Wizards packaging up something and getting him there to be with John Wall.
Ooh, that would be interesting.
Yeah.
See,
they had the same alma mater. So,
I'd like to see Boogie Cousins end up with the Knicks, because I think the only person in the NBA who could coach
Boogie Cousins so much.
I just like his name.
Just call him Boogie. Boogie. It's either Boogie or Cousins.
Okay. But I think the only person who could coach Boogie is Phil Jackson. I know Phil Jackson's not the coach of the Knicks, but he's in charge. He runs the Knicks. Stop. And I feel like Boogie is the only person.
Dude, Phil Jackson is. He's running. He's gonna be running out of New York with his tail tucked.
Oh, he's going back to the Lakers for sure. I know.
He's not like that organization.
But I'm saying. Phil would be the perfect mentor for Boogie. Because Phil's handled, Michael Jordan and he's handled Kobe.
So
he's handled those like superstars that think they're bigger than the world.
He needs a team that isn't going to be a laughing stock. Like, he needs to be on a good team that's competitive. If you're a star player, that's gonna be getting max money.
Yep.
On a shitty team, and am I allowed to swear?
Well, a little bit.
if you're on a
bad team,
not a very good team, let's just say, okay, yeah. that's being generous. Kind to them. Then, as the best player, you're like, yo, what's going on? Like, this is the same thing. Like, except LeBron got the Cavs to the finals, but his whole time there, it took him 6-7 years. Get me some players. Like, his next best player on that team in the finals was Anderson Varejão. Anderson Varejão was his wingman in the finals when they got swept by the Spurs. And he's like, yo, I can't do this anymore. Like, who do I have?
That's fair.
But DeMarcus, I guess they tried to bring in Rondo last year, who's, I think, on his last life. You know, I don't know. But it's either
They had Rondo, Cousins, and Rudy Gay. And that's like the three most uncoachable players in the league.
Rudy Gay is like an injury machine. I don't even know if he's playing. But that guy, I don't know. But I feel for Boogie. I think he deserves to be on a good team.
And the ownership there just doesn't know. They don't have a clue.
Shaq is a part owner of that team.
No. So you know. Shaq's a part owner of that team?
The Sacramento Queens that he once called. The Sacramento Queens. He's now part owner.
That's a very Shaq thing to say.
Yeah.
All right. So I kind of want to talk a little bit about how the Cavs got, or not the Cavs, the Warriors got four guys in the All-Star game. I think that's unfair.
Because?
There's 14 other teams in the conference.
We come back to the same. Who are you putting on? Instead of, like, the only guy you might make a case for is Draymond. Clay, I think. Like, the first person I thought was, how is Damian Lillard on that team? Like, that's the only thing that I...
But since... since Durant's gotten to OKC, or not, since he's left OKC, right, Klay has been put in a seriously diminished role. Because it used to be the Klay and Curry, the Splash Brothers, right? And now it's the Curry and Durant bit, right? And so I don't know that Klay needs to be there. I just don't, because he's been bumped down to a lesser role. Draymond for sure can get out of there. He definitely doesn't need to be there.
I mean,
and I'd like to see LaMarcus Aldridge there, because I think he's, I don't think he gets enough credit for what he's done.
He tweeted about that, saying something about like four players. I mean,
I don't think he gets enough credit for what he's done in
San Antonio.
Yeah. And kind of that whole like taking over from Tim Duncan and transitioning that area from like Tim Duncan and Manu to Kawhi and LaMarcus.
I mean, I feel like there's other guys like, I mean, on Memphis, like maybe Conley could have. I mean, Conley's more of a defensive player, so I really don't know. Like, if
he's not exciting enough.
Yeah, I mean, but Draymond's not really that exciting either.
Or let's get some of those Lakers kids. They're exciting.
They are.
The Lakers are still bad, but I like them.
Again, like you go to, if it's a popularity contest, like it's
if it's a popularity contest,
you got to go by the vote. Like, I mean, that's, I actually don't. It would be nice to actually have the breakdown of, like who, like because it was three parts, right? It was like 50% of it. It was the fan vote.
Yeah.
25% was the players' vote. Who actually
took
it as a joke?
And the last part was I think was the media.
Yeah, there's a media vote.
There's a media company.
So I don't know. Like, I don't know who else would put on.
So here's my thing. You remember last year at the NHL All-Star Game when John Scott got voted in by the fans?
Yeah.
Right? And now the NHL took away fan voting and it doesn't work the same anymore?
I don't know. I disagree. Like, I mean, you control all you want, but at the end of the day, the All-Star Game isn't for the league. Like, it is for the fans.
I know.
Like, it's an event for the
fans. And that's one thing I'd like to see. And then when you say the players didn't take it seriously, I'd like to see them take it seriously.
Yeah.
I mean, if you got a bunch of guys voting for Chris Anderson, I love Chris Anderson. So Mr. Birdman is great.
He got traded, hey?
Yeah, I know. Yeah. But and he's been injured for a while, too. But, I mean, if you got, like, a bunch of guys voting for an injured Chris Anderson because everyone loves Chris Anderson, I mean, what's the point of that?
Well, the thing that I think NHL was doing it strictly.
The NHL was doing,
was doing it because, okay, Zaza Pachulia.
Yeah.
Was leading the whole way with fan voting.
Yeah.
But he was, like, they take it, like, if for the starters, like, you need to have a high rank. Like, they rank players.
Right.
So Zaza was not even ranked among players, among just fan voting, right?
Yeah.
And so that's how we got left off the list. That's how you fix that democracy, essentially.
I know. I'd like to see the players take it a little more seriously and perhaps the fans have a little less say. Because I don't think most fans are a little, I don't think fans are smart. They're not.
That's why you have that safeguard. But that's, I guarantee you, that's why it would have been nice to have the stats. But that's probably why Klay Thompson and Draymond Green ended up on that team. Like, I would probably still put Klay on that team. Like, you look at who, I mean, look at the Western Conference. Like, you got...
Where's Chris
Paul? Like Damian Lillard, like Chris Paul's been injured, man. Like you can't. It's tough to put guys on there. Like you gotta put guys that are in the moment, right? Like it's got to be the moment of the league. And okay, maybe some of the Minnesota guys like LaVine or Wiggins, like that. That would have been. That could have been like those
put,
guys. Guys are entertaining to watch.
Put Andrew Wiggins in there. He's a young guy. He's an up and comer.
The players and the media didn't vote for him, right? Like the media's pretty. You gotta look at like media market. They're gonna put all of those Warriors on there, man, because the Warriors get prime time. Like the amount of cameras you probably see at every single Warriors game, any building is more than any other. Like their viewership on NBA League Pass has gone so high because everybody's watching them and everybody gets familiarity with them and they're like, man, Draymond is so, like, they might just be hidden from the fact that there's other players in this league that are good, but the fact that they're doing so well, not on pace as good as last year, but they're winning. They're playing at such a high efficiency, and you're seeing all these players every day because every day media is going to watch them.
Well, see that's the thing. So I want to go back 2 years ago when the Warriors won it all, right?
Yeah.
Okay. So they didn't break the record. It wasn't the glorious season, and the players all said, you know, we really don't care about the record, right? Because they came very close to it that year. I think they were like 68 wins or something like that, very close, but they didn't quite break it, right?
Yeah.
And the players and people said, oh, a super team like that is not good for the league because it takes away from you watching other games, and it's not good, right? And then last
everyone's watching them though.
Hold on, and then last year they break the record, but they don't win the championship,
right?
And they spent all last year being like, "We're going for it. We're going to try and break the record. We want to win 73 games," and they did it. And then they didn't win a championship. And so everyone wants to see is, can they take that next step? Can they?
Okay, so
can they be that 73 win team again and win a ring?
Can I ask you something? Okay, what? Here's a question. Take KD off there.
Yeah.
This was last year.
Yeah.
Curry, Draymond, and Klay make it. Do you have a problem with that?
For this year?
Just different year, let's say, whatever. Let's say it's this year and Kevin Durant is not there.
And they're... And
Curry makes it, Klay makes it, and Draymond makes it. Do you have a problem with that?
No.
Exactly.
But I got a problem.
But now, so just because, so now we're adding a guy who is arguably the second best player in the league.
Okay. Fair enough.
Ever. Okay.
He's really good. Settle down there.
He's really good. I'm not a fan of the Warriors, but man, you watch that guy.
Yeah.
It is effing unbelievable. Okay, I saved you
there. PG.
Right. I got you. PG. So you take him off, but like you're adding just a Mount Rushmore-esque basketball player.
Right.
And now you got to say, oh, well, that's too many Warriors.
It is.
But you,
we can get rid of Klay.
Yeah, if you put it in a vacuum, but like at the end of it's not fair to say if you take Durant off, now Draymond becomes an All-Star or Klay, whichever one you decide to take off.
But when
it's unfair to say, oh, they're not an All-Star anymore.
But when you add Durant, it diminishes the roles of one of those other guys, right? And if one of their roles is diminished, do they still deserve to be an All-Star unconditionally?
I mean, look, Draymond is still averaging close to triple-double this year, just so you know. Like, he's up there.
But
here, I'll look up his stats.
Is he doing it, though? Is Draymond average? I mean, because there's only one guy who's averaging a triple-double right now.
I understand, and he didn't get on the
stage. And that is a historic mark. It's only been done once before in the history of the league.
But
how can you? I don't know. How could you imagine if Connor McDavid was about to score, like, his, you know, 200th goal in a season, and we left him off the All-Star team. Like, you could never do it. If you're about...
No one's leaving nobody off the All-Star team here.
But he's not in the starting five. And if you're about to accomplish something that's truly historic, you should be an All-Star starter. In my opinion, that's a no-questions-asked if you're accomplishing a historic season-long
feat. Yeah, but, I mean, you're looking at it from a macro perspective. Like I was telling you, another argument...
Okay.
For the Warriors. Leaving Curry because you're going back to Westbrook, how is this so crazy. When you drop the Mount Rushmore of the Lakers, there is going to be one guy on there that if you're just looking at it and saying, oh, we left X off of that Mount Rushmore. Like, take four of the best Lakers. Yeah. You're either leaving off Will Chamberlain or Kareem. Like, I'm putting in Shaq, Kobe, Magic, and then pick someone. Right, so you're automatically going to leave someone off. So if you leave Wilt off, you're leaving off a guy who scored 100 goddamn points in a game.
Yeah.
Like, if you say it like that, you're like, yes, you're crazy. But there are so many good players that are on that list. Like, Shaq is the best center of all time. Kareem Abdul-Jabbar is the highest point getter of all time. Magic Johnson is Magic, and Kobe is Kobe.
Hold on. I'm leaving off Magic then.
Whatever, it doesn't matter. That's insane. I'm not even going to get to that.
Wilt, Kareem... Shaq, Kobe.
What, I'm not going to get into your ridiculous Laker theory. But even if you do that, you're leaving off somebody that's a Hall of Famer, right? Like, Westbrook is a potential Hall of Famer. He's having a Hall of Fame seat. Like, the season is insane.
Is Draymond a Hall of Famer?
Absolutely. I don't know. I don't know yet.
Do you think so? Do you think he will be?
It really look, man, it depends how his statistics show. Here, I'm looking it up. You keep... chirping away Laker theory. Man, okay, you know what? I don't know. 10.2 points, 8.2 rebounds, 7.3 assists.
He's almost averaging a triple-double.
1.5 blocks. Like, he's... So this is obviously a media vote and a player vote, because you look at stats like that...
Sometimes it's about more than what the numbers are. Sometimes there's other intangibles that guys bring to
the
team.
You're going against your Westbrook theory. He's a triple-double! You know, then you're going against that, but he is an entertaining player to watch.
I'm just helping you elaborate on your point. Settle down there.
No, you're not.
All right.
You're just settle down. You're just caught in a web, buddy.
For those who don't know, so I say settle down whenever I've like lost an argument. so I feel like it's time.
I see you a lot, bro.
I say it a lot. Yeah, sometimes I do. I feel like we should be switching over now. Let's talk about LeBron James and the Cavs. 24. What?
How long is this thing going to go? How did
you want it? Maybe like 10 minutes. Something
right.
like that.
Make it quick. All right.
All right.
LeBron James?
Yeah, LeBron James. So he wants a trade. He wants.
We don't know that.
I mean, he's publicly said it.
No, he just. He said he wants to tweak up the roster. So if you want to say he wants a trade.
So how are you tweaking that up?
Me?
Yeah.
Man, I don't know.
If you're the GM of the Cavs, how are you fixing that?
There's different. I don't know. The two big schools. I don't know. I gotta say that. I don't want to just take Charles Barkley's word. Like you've heard Charles Barkley. You've heard that whole.
Barkley called him whiny, and then LeBron called Barkley out on all his personal stuff.
I mean, it's not really like in terms of being whiny. Like I understand that you're the best. You're the considered the best team in the East. You see the team that you're probably going to face off. Like, they're not being nonchalant about it. They're saying that we're going to be in the finals. We're going to be playing the Warriors. And we got to get better. Yep. So, it's tough to argue against that.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you, every year, you're like, man.
When you watch.
Know, there's a mentality. You're like, once I'm the best, like, you can still get better. Right. So, there's that mentality to it. But if I'm just looking at basketball and I'm just taking, like, take a guy like AI who. Back in his day, man, he hustled himself. Like, he got that Philly team to the finals against the Lakers. He never, like, there's players back in the day, they never really asked for players like that. And there's been teams to win championships with far less than what LeBron has. Mind you, he's going up against the best team of all time in history. I understand. Like, it's incredible. But we also said that last year, the team that broke their record, right? And it's a matter of, you know, everyone says Eli Manning, he's on, you know, autopilot until the playoffs come.
Yeah.
Maybe not anymore, you know.
Yeah.
But I think that's the way that the Cavs work. When they get to the finals, Kyrie has another switch, and so does LeBron. Like, LeBron was insane in the playoffs last year. In the finals, he led in every stat category. It's just unprecedented stuff that guy does.
Do you know the two worst teams to be in the NBA Finals? Were both LeBron's Cavs teams. Not last year, but the year before that. And then the first Cavs
final. The one where they both got injured?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean.
Yeah. But, I mean, I find it, if you're LeBron, it's hard to sit there and watch the team you just beat, barely just beat, because they were down 3-1. It's hard to sit there and watch the Golden State Warriors add Kevin Durant and then watch them run their mouth all season about how they're going to be in the finals, right? And you're sitting there, and you've got Kevin Love, who plays zero defense. You've got, you know, you lost Matthew Dellavedova, which I know it doesn't sound big, but he's the guy who gave Kyrie a rest,
you know,
managing minutes. And if you look at it, LeBron has played more minutes in his career than Michael Jordan has ever played. He's played more minutes than any basketball player in the history of the league. And so that's going to catch up to him, right? By the time Michael Jordan had played even like 70% of this amount of minutes, right? There was a significant fall off in his play, and people said, "Oh well, he had, you know, played 3 years of college basketball, and he had gone and played baseball, and then he came back, and that's why he declined." But like LeBron has played
still one, still three beaten when he came back.
But I think Jordan had better teams, and I think LeBron. I'm kind of talking about legacy here, right? LeBron has carried more lesser quality teams to the finals than any player in the history of basketball.
This argument is not, we're not talking about.
And so I don't think it's whiny for him to say, hey, can I get a little help? Can we get a little bit deeper on the bench?
I think you're phrasing that wrong. Can we get a little, look.
Can we get some depth?
They won the championship.
Yeah.
Okay, and I know that's maybe that people don't like that argument. They're like, well, look how much better the Warriors got. But man, to say that you don't have a good, like you have solid players, and all it is, it sometimes, look, I'm just going to read you the team. This is the team that beat the Miami Heat in LeBron James in the last season there.
The San Antonio team?
The San Antonio team, okay?
Okay.
The starting lineup, given these guys were, okay, Tim Duncan was still, you know, all-star.
Solid.
I'll put him in all-star. Danny Green, Kawhi Leonard, Tony Parker, and Tiago Splitter. Okay? Now, coming off the bench, tell me if you know these guys. I do, but maybe you don't. Patty Mills, Corey Joseph, James, Manu Ginobili, Boris Diaw, Austin Day, Matt Bonner, Marco Bellinelli, Aaron Baines, and Jeff Ayers.
Actually,
are you going to tell me, are you now, are you going to tell me that Kyrie, Iman Shumpert, J.R. Smith, Kevin Love, Kyle Korver now, don't forget LeBron James, the best player
in the history of basketball. He's my number one of all time. I've got him ahead of Jordan.
I won't refute it. No, okay. That's okay. Anyways, I'll put him number two. You got that guy that is a straight killer, man. And to me, like, it just tells you, like, if Allen Iverson had this team,
right,
that just won,
they'd never lose another game.
Dude, it's over. Like, right. He is so, like, Allen Iverson had so much confidence, and a lot of these other guys, like, I'm not even mentioning Barkley, because he copped out and he went to Houston and did the same thing. So you can, well, you know, he can say whatever he wants. He gets paid to, you know, say crazy things. But if Kobe has that team, or if MJ has that team that just won, like, you got to come into our house. Like, I'm not going and being like, oh, we need all this and we need, you know. It does kind of come off as whiny. I understand you got to go up against Kevin Durant. Dude, they beat them this year game. They played two games. The first game, okay, Kyrie, miracle shot, whatever, they won. Then they lost by 20 or 30, whatever. But you still beat them. You're 1-1 this season with that amazing team that just can't be beaten.
Hold on. How does this, though, okay? They lose Matthew Dellavedova in free agency. Then they trade him. Then they trade Timofey Mozgov, because he's not there anymore, right? Mozgov's gone. Yeah. Okay. J.R. Smith.
Timofey Mozgov didn't play a single. I didn't see him in the finals.
Rim protector.
I didn't see him in the finals, dude. Dellavedova, you have a point. But if you're gonna say we lost Matthew Dellavedova, hold the phone.
Dude, he got 40.
We need a player.
Hey, he got 40 million.
Yeah, he got paid. Sure. Yeah, he was a big part of that
team.
He's
no slouch.
He was a big part of that team. But if you're gonna say we lost Matthew Dellavedova, we need to stop the train, and we need to rebuild.
Well, no.
Your first place, man, just grind it out.
There's a point here, okay? So they lost Matthew Dellavedova, right? And then J.R. Smith is currently injured, right?
Okay.
So who comes in and gives Kyrie Irving a break for a few minutes? Like, Kyrie doesn't have to play 45 a game,
right? I'm not saying...
Some other bum from the bench who's completely useless.
It's the way he goes about it, though, is like going to the media and saying, oh, like, oh, we need
you
help.
You should totally not be going to the media.
Because the way he says it, it's like, we're desperate. We need to fix this. If they didn't say anything and it's just a random Tuesday and they picked up point guard X,
yeah,
people would be like, oh, good addition. The same way they did with Kyle Korver. When they traded Dunleavy for Korver, they're like, oh, good addition. That might be good.
Right.
And that might be good because he's one of the best shooters in history also.
So LeBron is not wrong for wanting more help, right? But it's the way he's gone about trying to get that help, I think, is where we've come to is he would be totally okay to say internally to like the GM and their basketball operations people there, you know, our roster needs a couple more depth pieces.
I don't know. Another thing that I say, like, as a fan, like a fan of the game, like, I'm a big LeBron fan, and seeing him upset the Warriors was amazing. Like, coming back from 3-1 against Goliath was a big deal. Like, consider if the Warriors win it this year. Yeah. Of course, they're going to be ecstatic, right? Like, we revenged our loss.
But no one's going
to... But as a fan, or as a fan of basketball, you're not going to be watching that and saying, what an amazing championship team.
No, because you expect the Warriors to win.
Because they broke the record without the best player in the world, and then they add the guy. So...
Of course.
Like, it comes back to you wanting to battle. Like, I keep taking Charles Barkley's words, but it's part of it is... battling, and that's what makes the victory so sweet. Like when LeBron went to Miami, they lost the first time to Dallas. You come back, you tune little things up, and you revenge the loss.
Right. So you had your roster there for the San Antonio. This is the current roster of the Cavs, okay? Felder, yeah. Irving, Jefferson, Jones, Korver, Liggins, McRae, Shumpert, and an injured J.R. Smith. Those are your guards. And the forwards are Fry, James, Love, Thompson, Williams.
Derek Williams.
Derek Williams. There's a bunch of guys there that I couldn't tell you, like, who they are. You know, I've never even heard of them. Why Tristan Thompson doesn't get more playing time? Like, I think
he's a starter, man.
He'll be a starter now that Kevin Love's hurt.
He was always a starter.
Not really.
He was starting him and Kevin Love, yeah.
But but like there was a. I think it was last summer when Tristan Thompson was in contract talks. And LeBron was really pushing them to pay him a max salary because LeBron loves Tristan Thompson.
Yeah.
He plays defense. Saying,
like, okay. It's tough to make that compare. Like, the Warriors have the best team, like, pound for pound.
No, it's their
every single position. But, like, I read you the Spurs lineup, and yeah. You got guys like, is Boris Diaw at that time, were you going to say, oh, what an amazing... No, but he played a role, right?
Right.
The same way guys like Kyle Korver... Like,
he's going to play a role. He's
going to play a huge role. If they can, if Tyronn Lue, like, this is up to Tyronn Lue. If he can make it work, like, you got to look at your team and be like, we just won. We have the best player in the world. We have arguably one of the, probably the best point guard in the league. Yes. Personally, I think.
Kyrie is better than.
One or two. I don't know. The clutch shots that he makes, I'll give it to Curry, sure, but he's up there. He's two.
Yeah.
You have those two guys, and you have a base of other guys that play significant roles. Like Tristan Thompson came up big, and all you need to do is have those guys come up big in the finals.
Do you happen to know when J.R. Smith is going to be coming off?
They said they're just doing tests on him now. Because earlier than expected, they were doing these. Because
I think
should be a couple weeks.
I think once J.R. Smith is healthy, I think LeBron's concerns will go away because I think J.R. Smith is that depth piece on the bench.
Yeah.
And so while he's injured, okay, but he's more of a depth player than anything, right?
Okay.
So I think, you know, while he's, you know, once he's healthy, right, LeBron's concerns about tweaking the roster will have gone away because that depth piece that he wanted will have been back and it'll have been added internally without adding payroll. And the GM and the owner don't want to add payroll.
Okay, so what are you thinking that the Cavaliers should add?
I don't think they need to add anything. I think they need to get healthy.
Trade?
I think they're fine. Hold on, okay.
You're talking about Melo, though.
I was, okay. So I think if they're going to make a trade, I think they're going to trade Kevin Love for Carmelo Anthony. Because LeBron and Melo are friends.
So is LeBron and Kevin.
Not to the same extent. Like, Melo and LeBron go on vacations in the Bahamas. No, but LeBron and Melo go on vacation in the Bahamas together. So. LeBron and Love are not, you know, doing that together.
You don't know.
So, you're right, we don't. But publicly, we do know that, like, you know, LeBron's ideal team is LeBron, Dwayne Wade, Carmelo Anthony, Chris Paul, and then a bunch of scrubs.
Sure. I mean.
They've said that publicly, that you know, like, one day in maybe, like, 2019 or something, he'd like to reunite the boys and get them all together.
Yeah,
and
they're all, like, injured.
I know. They're like, all
full of injuries playing.
Dwayne Wade will be, like, extinct. He'll be a dinosaur.
Dude, that situation in Chicago is not...
No, good. That is not a good situation.
Have you seen that?
Yeah, but we'll talk about that later. So, I don't know. What do you think about LeBron or K-Love for Melo? I guess this is kind of our final thoughts here. We're starting to wrap this up a bit.
Yeah, that seems like a popular choice. You hear it ever. I don't think that's usually when usually so many people are saying that's a trade that's not going to happen. And
yeah.
Melo came out. And, I mean, Melo's been a good sport given all of that has happened with the Knicks, with Phil Jackson and
I think that's just a toxic. Situation.
He's been really mature. Like I've gained a lot of respect for Melo.
Yeah.
But
I think
he said he's staying. LeBron James said I never went to management to ask for a trade with Kevin Love. I didn't do anything. So as far as we know, I think that team stayed. Like I don't think Kevin Love's going anywhere.
I think as of right now, I think the Cavs are fine. I don't think they need to add anything. J.R. Smith's going to get healthy. He's the depth piece that they need. And then if you look at it, who in the East is going to beat them, right? Like before, so Serge Ibaka just got traded to the Raptors, but I don't think adding
That trade, Terrence Ross.
I think it's a pretty good trade.
Yeah,
but I don't think adding Serge Ibaka to the Raptors, I don't think the Raptors beat the Cavs in seven games. I just don't.
With Ibaka, I mean.
But I think the Cavs have more.
The Cavs are going to have a tougher road this year. Like Boston looks.
Boston's good.
Boston's formidable.
Toronto's
Washington's
pretty decent.
Okay.
Washington's terrible. Don't give me Washington.
I don't know, man.
They're terrible.
John Wall.
They got the best
backcourt. That guy's nickname should be Boogie, man.
They got the
Wall,
best.
DeMarcus Cousins.
Got the best backcourt in all of basketball. They say. But like, it's no, don't give me Washington. The two teams that scare Cleveland and as you scare lately is Toronto and Boston.
Boston, yeah.
And I don't see those two teams really having a strong chance of beating Cleveland in seven games.
Yeah.
You know, I think they could take it to seven games, but I think Cleveland would win that over the vast majority of the times.
The Knicks scare them?
No, the Knicks are nothing. The Knicks are absolutely nothing.
Pretty bad.
Philly is nothing.
Well, Philly.
Yeah,
they're gonna be better though.
They're gonna be good in a few years.
I'm liking that team.
I'm liking how they're building that. Anyways,
they got to bring Iverson back. Run that point.
What is he like 50 now?
I don't know.
He'd be pretty old. All right, so I guess you want to do a little bit of a shameless plug for your... No, you're good? All right. I normally at the end of every podcast let my co-host have like a 5-minute bit where they could talk about whatever they want, but it's up to you if you want to exercise that or not. How classy. All right, so this is the 4th and 1 with today's basketball show. Hopefully you people enjoyed it, and we can do another one hopefully in the future when it comes to playoffs.
No.
All right. Remember to like us on Facebook and YouTube and hit that subscribe button.